On purpose or by accident, you've stumbled into the One-Shot Review series. Here we will take a look at various tabletop RPG settings and systems from the entry-level perspective. I have ran or played each of these games for a single story run over the course of one or two sessions. These videos are intended to convey our experience with these games and give you an idea of what you might expect if you decide to dive in too. As with any setting and any system, remember that it's entirely possible that we misunderstood some things. I explained the rules and concepts as we understood them over a few days of preparation. Please be kind. Getting it all correct is not the point. If we got it wrong, that means it's a potential stepfall you'll know to look for when you decide to run it yourself. And that is the point. Here goes. Shadows by Firelight, One-Shot Review, Alice is Missing. Overview. Alice is Missing is a game by Hunters Entertainment and designed by Spencer Spark. And I can tell you right now, I'm going to keep an eye on whatever he does next. This review is going to be a bit short. There are two good reasons for that. First, the setting is essentially generated from scratch each game session. Second, there is no system. The game is intended to be played by revealing cards and chatting with other players in a group chat, reacting to the plot twists, sharing your secrets in private channels, and try to figure out what happened to poor, missing Alice. Setting. The title says it all. Well, almost. A young girl is missing. One of the characters, Charlie, doesn't know that yet. The first line of every game is Charlie starting a group chat with all the other characters asking what's wrong. From that point on, anything can happen. You and the other players will take on the role of one of five characters who know each other and are close to Alice in some way. One is the older brother, one is the best friend, and so on. The relationship to Alice is set, but you get to choose all the details beyond that. For example, all the character cards have questions on them that set up a small mystery. Since the possible answers to those questions are infinite, therefore it stands to reason that you can play this game several times and get a completely different experience each time. Your older brother, Jack Briarwood, will never be the same as someone else's. Further customizing the experience are 5 preset locations and 5 preset suspects. Before the game starts, players will take turn describing why each of these places and people are suspicious in some way. Lastly, you get handed a motivation card, which will flavor how you approach the situation. The card also has 2 relationships written on it that you get to assign to another player. Those are things like, we used to be best friends, and they were always there for you. Just simple things that make sure you have at least some kind of tie to at least 2 other characters. So setting-wise, that's it. You improvise it all right before the game starts. Oh, and don't forget to record a voicemail of the last message you left Alice before she went missing. With all that done, you're ready to start. System. In Alice is Missing, one player is the facilitator. That person needs to read all the rules and understand how the game works so that they can make sure it flows well. They don't know more about the mystery than the other players. No one does. There aren't any rules to adjudicate either. In other words, there is no storyteller. There's really no system either. What happens is that once Charlie, always played by the facilitator, starts a conversation, a 90-minute cooldown starts. Characters catch up, bring Charlie up to speed, and roleplay just flows naturally from there, with the understanding that everyone needs to start trying to find Alice at some point. Every 10 minutes or so, a player is assigned a clue card. Each of those cards have vague instructions and questions on them that the players need to work into the ongoing group chat conversation. Here, too, the possibilities are endless, as the questions are left open-ended, often paired with a random suspect or location card. That is the only mechanic in play here. Go wild, make stuff up, that's the mechanic. Don't worry about what's gonna happen next. No one knows what the mystery is, and the cards won't give answers. The only thing you can't do is mention that you found Alice, her car, or her phone. Those can show up in clue cards. Anything else is fair game. Whoever draws a card next will include whatever you say into the narrative in a way that makes sense. Here's an example. A clue card might have you draw a random suspect card, tell you that this suspect just walked up to you inquiring about a particular subject or item insistently. You get to decide what that thing is, why it's suspicious, and how it fits into the narrative built so far. The result is an experience that starts slow, builds up intensity as it goes. Theories rise and fall, relationships are tested, and nerves are frayed. Things can get pretty dark, so make sure you have a good conversation about lines and veils before you start. The game comes with a few ones to get you started, but feel free to add your own as needed. When the timer hits zero, the mystery is solved. You listen to the voicemails the others left Alice, and then you break the silence for the first time in 90 minutes. Conclusion. Alice is Missing is a very intriguing, experimental storytelling experience. In essence, it plays kind of like a murder mystery game, but one that is repeatable and where you get to actually do some meaningful roleplay. If that sounds like your cup of tea, then I highly recommend it. Just make sure to choose who you play with. This is not a fun Christmas party game to play with your folks. You'll need players able to improvise on the spot and who can delve into some pretty difficult topics. Lastly, I would say I really hope this idea catches on, or that they make more of them. It's a step in a bold new direction for the hobby, and I can't wait to see what else could be done with it.